time. Good morning, and I would like to welcome everyone to this, the fourth meeting of the Standards, Procedure and Public Appointments Committee in 2022. Our first agenda item is for the committee to consider the application for recognition from four cross-party groups. And the first group that we're going to consider, and I'm going to say good morning and welcome to Paul O'Kane, is a proposed CPG on changing places toilets. And I would like to welcome Paul O'Kane, MSP, who is the convener of the proposed group to this meeting. Morning, Paul. Would you like to make an opening statement about the intentions of the CPG, please?
Certainly. Thank you, convener, and good morning to committee. I'd like to propose a cross-party group on changing places toilets. The purpose of the cross-party group is to raise awareness of the essential need of accessible toilets for all of Scotland's citizens. And we would like to investigate the feasibility of a changing places toilet fund for local authorities and small community groups to access. This would continue the work of former MSP Mary Fee in conjunction with currently serving MSP Jeremy Balfour. Scottish Disability Charities and Scottish Changing Place Toilet Campaigners have been calling on the Scottish Government to recognise not all Scotland citizens are treated equally, and there is a section of society that cannot access basic human rights and have their needs met. And indeed, adults and children who have a disability are having their toileting needs met, often by lying on toilet floors with no privacy or dignity, and that's due to a lack of facilities. This can lead to a host of problems: infection, mental health, health issues due to not leaving their home, and the possibility of hospitalisation. In the long run, that affects the public purse. As a group, we would like to explore retail and business, how they can change their outlook on disability and how changing their business model could be beneficial to all. We would invite parents, carers, SEN teachers to join our CPG and give testimony of lived experience and what they would like the group to take the Scottish Government on board and consider. We would like to investigate the subjects of tourism, to investigate Scotland being a holiday destination of choice for families with a disability. We would like to focus on building design and the use of our public buildings and spaces in Scotland as well. And we would propose to work with the Royal Incorporation of Architects Scotland to discuss feasibility of changing designs of what a changing places toilet should be, and how these toilets can be placed in public buildings. Based on research, we would propose to include a changing places toilet standard for buildings across Scotland, and we would work collaboratively with government departments and ministers in this regard. So I would appreciate if committee would consider our application. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Paul. Do any committee members have any questions? Sue.
Thanks, convener. Paul, Mr O'Kane, sorry. Obviously, there's a contention at the moment that local authorities are having to close many of their public toilets for cost challenges, and particularly I've faced that significantly in the City of Edinburgh. Is that something that would be covered under the remit as well?
Thank you, and through the convener, thank Ms Webber for that question. I think that is vitally important. I think the CPG wants to look at the availability of facilities, because very often we know that families, particularly who have children who have a disability, struggle to access toilets in city centres, in places where they might go for a day out. Spontaneity is not possible for many families because they can't have access to those facilities. So it's certainly something we would want to look at with local authorities and others about where the provision exists currently and where there are gaps that could be filled.
Thank you.
Colette.
Yeah, thanks, Paul. And having read the papers, I did a bit of homework in terms of what changing places facilities will wear in East Kilbride in my own constituency. And it was quite alarming to see there's only one. And there is a website for changing places. I just wonder if that's something that, you know, as the cross-party group, you will continue to use and actually promote as well. I found it quite alarming for numerous reasons. I had somebody close to me who had colitis and needed to ensure that they actually had proper changing facilities as well. And notwithstanding that, I'm thinking of people who like breastfeeding and whatnot as well. I know from years ago it was quite undignified. So is this areas that you're going to look at as well? And in terms of the app, it'd be really interesting actually to look at it. Maybe, I don't even know, look at a local authority level to see how we can actually promote that better. And obviously notwithstanding the fact that Sue mentioned the challenges that we've got at local authority budget level. Thanks.
Thank you, and thank Ms. Stevenson for that question. I think that's vitally important. We have previously had engagement with UN's Guide, who provide a lot of information about accessible facilities, including changing places, toilets. And we're keen to engage further on that, because I think it is about acknowledging that we have made some progress, so that there are facilities available. The government has agreed to invest more in terms of our public buildings. But very often for families, it's ensuring that they know what's available and where they can access in these facilities. I think the point is absolutely well made about town centres. And people be able to, as again, going back to the point I made to Ms. Weber, is knowing that they can plan a day out. Whether they even just want to go to the centre in East Kilbride, you know, to go shopping or something like that, but actually they have that level of surety that there's going to be a facility for them. The other area we've looked at and we're hoping to look at is mapping things like service stations, where if people want to go on holiday and they maybe want to drive to do the North Coast 500 or something, these places that we have on our doorstep in Scotland, that they're able to do that, because holidays are crucial, particularly for families with young children who have life-limiting conditions and disabilities. So certainly I think investment in understanding what the Map of Scotland looks like currently, being able to get that information out to people and being able to add to that map, I think is crucial. And I think it's certainly something all the partners who are involved in the CPG would want to take forward.
Can I just quickly come in, Convener? See, in terms of the criteria to meet a change in places toilet, is it quite robust and or is it difficult? You know, how easily is it to go on and actually be recognised as a change in places toilet?
I think the problem for many years has been that people perhaps have disabled facilities or have a certain level of facility which they would view to be a changing places toilet. However, there are a very clear set of standards around what a changing places toilet is, which obviously involves space requirements, it involves showering facilities, it involves ensuring that you essentially have the size to move around. And that's all laid out, and I can provide committee with that information if that would be helpful. But essentially, it is quite a robust set of standards. And I think part of the challenge is it can be very cost prohibitive often for organisations, particularly if you were a community organisation who run a community facility through asset transfer or something like that. You know, to put it in can be quite expensive. So I think that's why we want to work collaboratively with government to try and find a fund that would allow community facilities particularly to do that.
Thank you.
Thank you. I'd now like to invite Bob, who's joining us remotely today. Over to you, Bob.
Thanks, Convener. And can I thank Paul O'Kane for bringing this cross-party group to the committee this morning. I was following the conversation really closely and the paperwork, and you're quite right to talk about strains in the public purse, how we can direct cash most effectively to enhance a network of, you know, essential provision. And I think you make that point very well, and you made the point about tourism also. I'm just wondering, in terms of corporate Scotland, if you like, in terms of the duties and obligations that some of our were private companies, some who are still doing okay in the current climate, that they may have in terms of working with them in partnership to get them to maybe commit to putting in the kind of provision that changing place toilets would have with shower facilities and the like, and to make them publicly available and on that national network. So will there be a relationship, if you like, with the private sector or corporate Scotland in relation to that as well?
Thank you. I think Mr. Doris for the question. I think it's a very important question and certainly something that the CPG would be keen to engage in. I think it is Sainsbury's who currently have are doing work on a network of changing places toilets in store. That certainly is something that was of interest to us. Our other larger supermarkets are, again, places that are very often well located in terms of where people go and where they might be able to use facilities. I think we also have to work with in-town and out-of-town shopping centres and other commercial organisations to ensure that they are playing their part, because we know very often that they have the resource to be able to put these facilities in and to ensure that they are serving their customers better. So I think we would want to explore with them, but also with government, if there's anything further that could be done to persuade, cajole and perhaps compel the corporate world to do that.
Thank you, Bob. And I think just for the record, I noticed that Angela Dully, who is indeed a well-known campaigner, very well-known campaigner in this field, has offered to do the secretarial support for the group. Thank you for coming along today, Paul. We'll make a decision on this in the next session and the clerks will let you know in due course. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you to colleagues on committee.
Thank you. The next group that we're going to look at is a proposed CPG on Bangladesh, and I would like to welcome Faisal Chowdhury, MSP, who is the proposed convener of the proposed group, who is joining us online today. Good morning, Faisal. Would you like to make an opening statement about the proposed CPG?
Good morning, Convener. Can I thank you very much, Convener? I thank committee members for their time this morning. And I'm sorry, I didn't realize I could have attended in person. I thought everything is getting done through the BlueJean. The purpose of the cross-party group on Bangladesh is to promote and enhance understanding between Scotland and Bangladesh at a cultural, social, academic, political, and economic level. It's our intention to develop contact with the Bangladesh Parliament and other institutions, including the Bangladesh Consulate in Edinburgh and the Embassy in London, to progress such dialogues. It will also be advancing the mutual interest of Scotland and Bangladesh and in representing the interest of citizen organizations with Bangladeshi background in Scotland and acting as a forum for the community. From Bangladeshi community, there is a keen interest to know about the procedure of the Scottish Parliament, be part of the Scottish democracy, and learn what could be used for future elections in Bangladesh. I'll be doing this along with our friends in Westminster, with all the party group on Bangladesh, in working on research and developing a work plan for the growing Bangladeshi community in Scotland. The CPG would be a new group focused on Bangladesh and would not overlap any current CPGs. The areas of topics that were discussed at our initial meeting and will form our work plan will include investment, trade, tourism, travel, environment, and education. We want to build on the momentum we have from the COP26, where we made history by having the Bangladeshi Prime Minister right here in Parliament. We hear the challenges the country faces in the threat of climate change. COP26 has shown that we can only deliver genuine changes if we are united together. And I know the UK, Scotland, and Bangladesh will work shoulder to shoulder to tackle climate changes. Thank you, Convener, and thank you for listening to me.
Thank you very much, Faisal. It was a great pleasure to welcome the Prime Minister here during the COP26. Do any committee members have any questions? No? Could I just ask, you mentioned the connections with the APPG at Westminster, but this CPG will be distinct and separate from that, won't it? Concentrating on the Bangladeshi communities here in Scotland. So rather than just being a subset of the APPG, it will be a self-standing CPG operating on its own?
Yes, of course, yes. No, it's just to share their ideas, how they do it over there, just to get information. But our is mainly based on Scotland and the community from Scotland.
Thank you. And I must say, the list of organisations that the proposed CPG has reached out to and want to be involved, I think, is testament to the importance of the Bangladeshi community here in Scotland and the widespread understanding amongst Civic Scotland of that understanding. If there are no further questions, can I thank you for attending today. A decision on the CPG will be made at the next agenda item and the clerks will be in touch after the meeting. But thank you for attending today, Faisal.
Thank you very much, Convener, and thank you very much, Tim. Hope to see you soon.
Thank you. I would now like to invite the next proposed CPG, which is on migration, and I would like to welcome Paul Sweeney, MSP, who is the proposed convener of this new group, to the meeting. Good morning, Paul.
Good morning, Convener.
Give you an opportunity to take your seat, and would you like to make an opening statement about the intentions of this CPG?
Well, thank you very much, Convener, for inviting me to address the committee this morning. The proposed cross-party group on migration is quite a wide-ranging forum for stakeholders, policymakers and those with lived experience to discuss any matters arising in relation to migrants, refugees or those seeking asylum in Scotland. And whilst immigration policy is a reserved matter to the House of Commons, the cross-party group will engage, consider and raise awareness of ways in which we can make an impact on issues regarding immigration and migration, asylum and refugees in Scotland, because there are a number of important interfaces with the Scottish Parliament's competences as well as with local government colleagues, and therefore having an integrated approach is vital to improve quality of life for people affected by current policy. So this is definitely something that's well established as a public interest. There isn't currently a CPG focusing on this area in Holyrood, despite thousands of people in Scotland being impacted by those issues. So the creation of the cross-party group would be particularly beneficial given recent significant and relevant events taking place, such as the passage of the Nationality and Borders Bill by the UK Parliament and the ongoing humanitarian crisis in Afghanistan.
Thank you very much. Do any of the committee members have any questions for Paul about the proposed CPG? Oh, please, Tess.
I'd just like to ask Mr. Sweeney, what are your key measures of success? Thank you.
Well, the key measures of success are to effectively expedite policy ideas that key stakeholder groups, particularly in Glasgow, have been advocating. The vast majority of almost all asylum seekers in Scotland are resident in the Glasgow City Council area, because it's the only city or the only council area in Scotland that participates in the dispersal programme. However, there are refugee communities and resettlement programmes through the refugee programme that are dispersed around Scotland. So there are a number of concerns that have been raised by key stakeholder groups, particularly Maryhill Integration Network, who have been especially instrumental in helping to establish the cross-party group, and issues around exclusion from housing issues, so transport issues, social exclusion. Obviously, we had the tragedy with the Park Inn disaster in Glasgow last summer, the summer of 2020, sorry. So mindful of all these issues, I think it's important to bring together this forum to allow us to sort of channel frustrations, channel issues where potentially Scottish Government can help ameliorate some of the concerns that people are experiencing on the ground. And it's largely in a humanitarian sense. It doesn't necessarily interfere with immigration policy or even with no recourse to public funds, which is a potential condition on social security support. So on these measures, for example, one suggestion has been extending concession of travel to asylum seekers, which would be within the gift of the Scottish Government. So ideas like that, for example, could be promoted by the cross-party group.
Thank you. Convener, may I also ask about any overlap with the Petitions Committee? Is the intention that the CPG identifies issues and then we'll move towards petitions?
It hasn't been something explicitly discussed thus far. However, it is a helpful suggestion, and I can envisage that potentially being a measure. I think there is an effort to try and engage with stakeholders, perhaps directly with ministers, and perhaps directly with NGOs and various other organisations, just to try and pool understanding, share sort of common practice. There's quite a wide range of organisations supporting the CPG. I've listed them, but I can go through them. Maryhill Integration Network, The Voices Network, Safe in Scotland, British Red Cross, UNESCO, Scottish Detainee Visitors, particularly in relation to Dungavel, Just Right Scotland, Positive Action in Housing, Migration Policy Scotland, Refugees for Justice, Govern Community Project. So there's quite a rich ecosystem out there, but often people are operating in silos and are kind of disjointed. So part of the function of the CPG will help to sort of act as a sounding board so people can share experiences, rally around common themes such as housing, transport, income, deprivation, poverty, etc., and hopefully pull together actions that we can share objectives on and then push them into the government to sort of ask if we can get improvements or measures to address them.
Okay. Thank you, Tess. Bob, can I just bring you in?
Yes, thank you, Convener, and thank you, Paul Sweeney, for taking this cross-party group to the committee this morning. I should, of course, declare an interest. It was a pleasure to go on to the first meeting of the proposed cross-party group with Paul and others, and should this group be successful and been established, I would be the deputy convener of that cross-party group, so I should declare that interest. You can probably take from that, convener, that I may have a a goodwill towards the committee agreeing to recognise this cross-party group. I'll just make one observation, and that is that immigration is absolutely a reserved matter, but caring for those who have chosen to make their lives in Scotland, whether fleeing violence or persecution, or for whatever other reason they've came to our shores, of course, is not a reserved matter. It's the core business of representing our constituents, irrespective of where they came from or how long they've been in Scotland. And I think this cross-party group will go some way to making sure that our Parliament can fulfil that important role.
Thank you for that, Bob, and the indication that of your interest in this matter. And although not a formal requirement under any of the rules, I'm sure that you will extend the usual practice of stepping out in respect of the decision with regard to this CPG. But we very much note your interest, and I saw both Paul and your eyes whirring at the idea of a petition. Colette, I think you have a question.
Yep. Thanks, Paul. I very much welcome this CPG. And just recently, there's been several issues arising within East Kilbride in terms of accommodation and even their status in terms of whether they're asylum seekers or refugees as well. So it was interesting to find that out. But what I found quite alarming, and I'm just wondering if it's something that will come up in terms of within the CPG, is that despite the fact they've actually got hotel accommodation, which is very basic, is they only get £8 per week.
Yeah, the income allowances provided to those who are in the asylum process are very meagre indeed. So if you're in bed and breakfast accommodation, you are only basically getting £1 a day. If you're in a flatted accommodation, it's slightly more than that. It's about, I think it's £7 a day. So you can imagine even on that basis, it's very well below even baseline social security that a citizen would be entitled to. So there are acute poverty and deprivation issues. The reason for the B&B is because the housing provider, which is a contract between the Home Office and a private sector operator called Mears Group, they are basically obliged to provide accommodation for those in the asylum system. Because of the pressures on the system, they aren't able to acquire enough housing units from RSLs and registered social landlords and private providers to put everyone in flats. So they're actually now kind of putting people into hotels to sort of backfill for the demand. But the problem is that's significant welfare problems there, as I mentioned about the Park Inn disaster, that actually emanated from people who were suffering acute mental health problems, trauma, being corralled into these kind of hotels. The catering, for example, wasn't culturally appropriate, so then they were serving food that they couldn't digest. You know, getting a cooked breakfast if you're from sub-Saharan Africa isn't really something you can eat. You know, so just, if, for example, having an opportunity to provide feedback from stakeholders on the ground to say to the housing provider, for example, this is a really big problem, we really need a grip on this, could help perhaps improve the situation at the margins. And it's these little things that could potentially solve a lot of bigger problems that can potentially cause, you know, risk to life, you know, given the high pressure situation that often people who have fled from severe, you know, disastrous situations can experience. So, yeah, for all those kind of reasons, I think it's a really important CPG to offer that kind of sounding board within the Parliament, give more rapid access to ministers, to the sources of raising things in the chamber, for example. So I think it will be worthwhile in that sense.
No, thank you. That's very welcoming indeed. Thank you.
Thank you, Colette. I suppose just for purpose of clarification, the CPG is described, well, is going to be called the Migration CPG. We've talked a lot about asylum and refugee status. Is the intention to look at the broader, in due course, look at the broader migratory pressures and challenges that people might face coming to Scotland?
Thanks, it's a very important point. I think we've deliberately defined it in a broader sense because I think a lot of these have important interfaces. For example, access to student opportunities. There's a wider issue around EU migration and the future status of EU citizens in Scotland and the UK, and broader demographic challenges faced in Scotland around an ageing population base and a narrowing tax base. So, you know, having a larger working age population is an important function of a sort of sustainable economy. Therefore, we need to have a greater infusion of working age people. So that's all going to be part of that discussion. And trying to frame the whole, you know, issue of migration in a less confrontational way and a bit more in a sort of sensible, sort of rational fashion. And I think that would be a broader idea about it. Though I think the Secretariat, being Mary Ellen de Gratian Network, highly engaged with asylum seekers, colours the initial objectives of the CPG, but it can evolve, I think, and that's why we've left it kind of looser.
No, thank you for that. Thank you for that clarification. And thank you for also putting on the record from Maryhill Integration Network, who've offered the Secretariat that. Thank you. Can I thank you for attending today, Paul? The committee will consider whether to approve the application for recognition in the next agenda item, and the clerks will inform you in due course of the outcome. Can I thank you for that?
That's great. Thank you, Convener, and thanks to everyone for your consideration.
Thank you. There'll now be a short suspension while we change witnesses. Can I welcome people back, and can I welcome Jeremy Balfour, who joins us today for the proposed CPG on older people, age and ageing, which I will quote very carefully. And can I invite Jeremy Balfour, MSP, who's the proposed convener, to make a statement about the intentions of the group. Good morning.
Good morning, convener. Good morning, colleagues. Convener, this is a slightly different from the two previous one, is that this cross-party group, in fact, were the very first cross-party group to be established within the Scottish Parliament back in 2000. Unfortunately, just due to administration and due to Sandra White not standing, we just were a bit slow off the mark in getting our ducks lined up. However, we have now got the ducks lined up and we are ready to go. I'm very keen to go. Without being too rude to most of us, this group applies to us, as Age Scotland now define old as 50 plus. Not you, not well. I'm not asking anyone to declare an interest on that. But obviously, you know, this is a big issue. We are an ageing population. There are many challenges that older people face. And I think, particularly over the last 2 years, we have seen the challenge of isolation. We've seen the challenge of getting back into employment, and we have seen the whole issue of care at home. And so those are, without prejudging our agenda, will be some of the issues that we will be looking at over the next coming months. We have already decided, if we are allowed to go ahead by the committee this morning, that the first one we will be doing is trying to get as much information we can on the experience of the last 2 years, so that as a cross-party group, we can feed that in to the public inquiry, which will be taking place. And I think it will give an insight across the whole of Scotland, both from organisations, but also individuals. And then beyond that, we will be looking at other issues. So I hope we will be able to continue, and happy to take any questions from you or other colleagues.
Thank you very much for that, Jeremy, and also for pointing out the pre-existence of this CPG. And your explanation with regard to the administrative areas, but also can I thank you for the steps that you've taken today in the reapplying for it to be re-recognised. Thank you for that. Do any of the committee have any questions? Sue, over to you.
Just a quick one. Thank you, Jeremy Balfour. There's a lot of stakeholders on your list, and I'm just wondering how you foresee managing that. It's quite, because it does affect all sorts of the society.
Yeah, believe it or not, that's a cowed down list. So the list was about double that size. But what we did before we proceeded was that we emailed everybody that had been part of the group in the previous parliament, and about half of them had either moved on or were no longer involved. So it is a very large group. I think, and it's an interesting one, we had the cross-party group on disability on Tuesday, and it was very interesting that almost everybody wanted to do it by Zoom. And I think that makes a massive difference. So rather than having to come here as it used to be, people can now log in if they're in Inverness, Aberdeen, wherever. And I think that will probably be the model that we look at going forward, at least for the majority of our meetings, so that it does mean that people can take part. We do have a an official kind of smaller working group that meets to help set the agenda, which is then obviously then fed into the wider group to get their approval for it, because it is a large group. But I actually think for me it's a positive, because there's such a diversity. You know, if you go from 50 to 100 plus, that's a lot of different interests. Some people are working, some people have retired, etc., etc. So it is a large group. But, and I have to say, in the previous parliament, when we used to meet here, we had to take the largest committee room because it used to be jam-packed. So we do hope to have some face-to-face meetings as well.
Thank you, Convener. That's great.
Thank you for that, Sue. And just as a point of clarification, Jeremy, I note that Christine Ryder from Outside the Box, that is a facilitating charity, is my understanding, have offered secretarial support, but they're not listed as one of the MSP, non-MSP members of the group. Is that because they're just offering the secretarial support and the facilitation rather than contributing to content of the CPG?
No, that's right. So they're going to be offering secretariat work. But the country, I mean, obviously we will be there, but it's a slightly different relationship. But they also are quite new to this, and so I think they're just wanting to put their feet into the water, and they may well actually become members quite quickly. But I think at the moment that's the relationship that we're looking at.
That's excellent. Thank you for clarifying that. Thank you for coming along this morning. As I say, we'll take the decision in the next agenda item, and the clerks will be in touch in due course with that decision. But can I thank you for coming along this morning?
Thank you.
We can now move to agenda item 2, when it is for the committee to consider whether to accord recognition to the proposed cross-party groups for Bangladesh, for changing places toilets, for migration, and for older people, age and ageing. I would now like the committee, and I'd like to invite the committee, if there are any questions or comments that you'd like to make before I formally put the proposal to us. Anyone? No? Excellent. Then, our members agreed to accord recognition to the proposed cross-party groups on Bangladesh, changing places, toilets, migration, and older people, age and ageing. We are in agreement with that, and at that point, can I close the meeting and thank everyone for their attendance today.